My name's Neil Kelly. I'm a regional extension agent. I cover all the wiregrass region. Got to cover 12 counties in the wiregrass area. Deal primarily with commercial horticulture. People a lot of times ask me what all falls into that, and I say, well, anything other than cotton, peanuts, corn, or the typical row crop. I get a little bit of a lot of fruit trees, a lot of vegetable production, pecan production, turfgrass production. So they've got to stretch kind of thin, cover a little bit of all of it, just like a lot of the other regional agents. We'll talk a little bit about plasticulture and some of the advantages and disadvantages of plasticulture. We're just going to hit on sort of the big picture. There we go. Just to give credit to you, Dr. Joe Kimball, he's our extension specialist in Auburn. I pretty well borrowed his slideshow, changed a few things here and there. There's some information borrowed from other universities in it as well. So just to give credit where credit's due. Just a few advantages of a plasticulture production system. Some of the big things we're looking at is earlier production, higher yields, cleaner and higher quality produce. Looks at everything when you're working these local markets. And the cleaner and nicer looking the produce is, the better chance you have of selling. So we're looking at cleaner, higher quality produce. The conservation side of things, we fall in right here under a more efficient use of water. Fruits and vegetables are upwards of 85 to 95% water. So irrigation is pretty much a must when we're growing commercial fruits and vegetables. You can take a drip system operating properly, you're looking at 15 to 25% of your water required compared to overhead systems. So you see a huge savings in your water that's required to produce a crop. By better managing this water use right here, we are helping to reduce leaching of fertilizers. And then, of course, the barrier on the surface also helps to reduce the effect of fertilizers from environmental conditions. Here you can see is a crop of melons that was planted. It was just something that they were doing for demonstration. And what they've done is they're both on the drip, obviously, because the next large component to a plasticulture system is the irrigation. So they're both on drip here. You can see they're planted at the same time, and you can see the size difference in the plants. So you can see the rapid growing plant leads to that earlier production. Talk about higher yields, and I've got some data in the next slide or two that kind of gives you a little bit better or an idea of how much higher yields can be under plastic. But here's a shot of a tomato field, and you can just see a rib of the tomatoes really loading up with fruit here. Being on plastic here, we're putting a barrier between the crop and the ground, so we are keeping cleaner fruit. We don't have near the splash up off the soil and that kind of thing. Again, just another shot in the field, just to give you an idea of what some of these production systems look like. That's a shot of cantaloupes there on the plastic bed. Talk about yield increase. What are we looking at? Now, this comes from the North Carolina Department of Ag. These figures did. We're very similar in the state of Alabama as well. What these are compared back to is the state average. What these numbers are compared back to. You can look on something like tomatoes. That's a very popular crop on plastic. You're looking at 2,500 boxes to the acre, three times the state average on bare ground. Cucumber was really impressive. You look at cucumber production, 1,200 bushels to the acre. That's five times the state average in North Carolina. And all these yields here are very reasonable yields. I would say that we could achieve any of these yields in Alabama as well. So you can see over here anywhere from three to five-fold increase in production. Some more of the advantages of plastic culture. We're reducing soil and wind erosion. Potential decrease in incidence of disease. Fewer weed problems. We can better manage the real estate, so to speak, that's under that plastic. So fewer weed problems, elimination of root pruning with plowing and other chemical methods of weed control. The facilitates double cropping as well. Some people might ask, what is double cropping? What it is the potential to follow one crop with another on the same plastic bed, getting more than one season or more than one crop growth out of that plastic. Fairly good rotation to bell pepper, followed by summer squash, cucumber, either cold crops. Tomatoes, you can follow the cucumber, the summer squash, or cold crop. If you had summer squash, you can follow them out with fall tomato. Watermelons, you can follow out with fall tomato, bell pepper, eggplant, some type of short season pepper crop. This is a tomato field. What's happened here is they're through with their tomato production. They've gone in and burned down everything, and they'll fall back in, and what they'll do is they'll plant a vine type of cucumber right into that plastic, right below those tomatoes, and push another crop out of it. That's the fish a little bit later after they've got the cucumbers in. They left all the old residue from the tomato field, everything left it there. They just went back and poked in between where the tomatoes were planted, and they dropped their cucumbers in there. The old tomato vines and stakes and the streams where they tie the tomato provides a little small trellis for the vine and cucumbers to run on. It looks like they followed some type of melon crop looks like a big squash, probably a fall squash crop. Another shot where they've gone through, they've actually cleaned the residue up. What it was is the original crop here would have been probably planted on 6 foot, on about a 6 foot space, and if it was something like melons, and they got ready to follow that, they burned everything down, pulled the plants. You just punch two extra holes between, and you're back to a 2 foot space, and you look at planting some type of pepper or something like that following the melon crop. Things to remember if you try this double cropping system, you want to keep the beds moist between crops. It can be really, really hard at times if you let this bed get too dry to ever get it back wet again. You have to just run and run and run irrigation. It takes quite a bit of water, and of course we're putting out very small amounts of water at a time, so it can take quite a long time to re-wet that bed. So you want to go ahead and try to maintain good soil moisture all the time under that plastic. Fertility based on each crop. You may need to do some soil testing, because it may be that the second crop that you plant, you may not have to put out a full recommendation, because there may be some fertility still in that soil from the nutrients that you put out for the first crop that they did not utilize. So, potential problems with plasticulture. Must be designed properly. This is something you're going to put a lot of work into putting this out there, and once it's out and you've got it laid, it is what it is. It's very difficult to go in and make changes once you've got plastic laid. So definitely want to take a long look at the design, make sure that you've got it designed properly. There is no universal design. I know you can ask Mr. William Holman here. He's been working on putting in a project that y'all will see later today out here at Landmark. And I think we probably changed that design 3 or 4 times now. We thought we had it all laid out right, and then we'd get out there and we'd get to discussing stuff and looking at it from this angle and that angle. And we've changed the design 2 or 3 times. So there is no universal design. What you're going to have to do is look at your place specifically, your field that you plan to put in plasticulture, where your water sources are, how you want to orient your rows, and you're going to need to lay out a plan of action for your particular farm. Consult experts. They are experts out there. I'm not going to claim to be one, but I can help you out with this. There's some guys that are in the irrigation industry that deal a lot with plasticulture that know their information. So there is help out there to be had. You just have to get out and look for it a little bit at times. Like I say, we're all stretched really thin, so you may not see us all on a regular basis, but we are available to help. Avoid shortcuts, and this is a big thing. A lot of people, I know we have to operate as efficiently as possible. We try to save every dollar where we can, but there are some places that we just don't need to shortcut, and I would say that one of these plasticulture type systems is one of those instances. Shortcuts always come back to bite you in this type of production. Drip or plasticulture may not be suited in every situation. There again, there are some crops to where the cost of the additional cost of the plastic and all of the drip pipe and the components of the system, the crop may not be high value enough to pay for that additional cost. So it's not for every crop. I know a lot of peas and beans, that kind of thing. We typically do not bother putting on plasticulture. So you just need to take a look at the cost versus the yields. Few pictures. This is a standard plastic layer. It's one of the more basic models. What you do is you have your roll of drip pipe up here. Your rolls of plastic laid right here on these rollers. It feeds down through to this bottom roller. In the center of this machine here is, I'll be honest, if you don't know the technical term, I consider it a press pan. That's what actually shapes your bed. It's got several little cultures in the center here that are filling dirt toward the middle. The big wings here having to pull all that dirt in. And it's all pressing the little square pan there that forms the bed. Like I say, kind of a basic plastic layer. It really does not take a very large tractor to handle a piece of equipment like this. Here's another shot of just a different manufacturer's piece of equipment. You can see the different milling discs right here in the center, how they're throwing dirt to the center. See the wings that are dragging in extra dirt, running through that pan, that bed former, their shaper. They've got plastic right here. What these press wheels on the side and the back are, what they're doing is they're holding down the edges of the plastic as those very back killers are cutting the edge of plastic with dirt to hold everything into place. See a little more elaborate setup here. Come in all different shapes and sizes. You can see the right here, the covering wheel. This is a good shot showing how the back wheel is holding the sides of the plastic down while the healing disc, the covering disc, are covering the edges of the plastic. We had full intention of laying plastic for y'all today out in the field. Obviously, with the 14, 15 inches of rain we've had in the past week or so, we're just not going to be able to do that, but we do have a machine out there, and we are going to take a few minutes to walk out and look at that, answer questions in the field, as well as you can see how far Mr. William and them have made on setting up their irrigation. It's actually a good time to look at it, to see some of the things that are going into the ground, some of the planting process that takes place laying out that. So we'll get to see that a little bit later in the field. This is kind of a cutout view of what that plastic bed is going to look like. Typically what we're looking at is about a 30-something inch wide bed right here, usually going to be about 36 inches wide. Typically look at laying like a 5 foot width type plastic, be 8-9 inches high, about 3 feet across the top, and you have a little on the sides that's covered with dirt there. Your drip tubing, for the most part, runs just off the center. When we're planting a single crop into that plastic, we usually plant that right down the center of the plastic. And we set the machine up so that it's laying the drip tube just off to one center. You don't want to get it too far off because we want to make sure that we're getting water over to the root system. But there again, you don't want it right in the center because you'll punch holes in it when you're transplanting. If you're planting something like strawberries, or if you're working in a twin row, so to speak, on plastic, you would lay your drip pipe right down the center, and you would plant to either side of that drip tank. Here's a picture of a press wheel. After we've laid our plastic, what we do is we go back with a machine similar to this. That press wheel's got little spikes on it, and you can change these punch wheels are interchangeable. So depending on what your crop spacing is, you may have to change out that punch wheel to get the right spacing. What we do is we go back, we punch our holes, and then we set our transplants, which is what these gentlemen here are doing. You can see the hole puncher just in front of them there.